Good afternoon, everyone. I'm Mel Garcia. I'm a chemistry professor at the Salle University. It's private universities in the Philippines. It's situated in Manila. And I'm here just basically to talk about how instrumental the Decent machine was in establishing the coffee academic program at in my university. So recently, we've been getting a lot of visitors in the coffee laboratory, even professors who are visiting from universities from all over the world. Apparently, know about the laboratory ahead of their hosts within the university. So even my colleagues inside the university are sort of surprised when the visiting professors ask them to bring them to the coffee laboratory. De La Salle University is, as I mentioned, it's a Catholic private university in the Philippines. It has a population of about 10,000 students all in all. We don't grow coffee in Manila, but I'll explain in a short while the reason why we engaged in an academic program right now. Just to provide the context, in the Philippines, being a tropical country, is capable of producing all four commercial types of coffee: Arabica, Robusta, Excelsa, and Liberica. Every year, we hold a coffee quality competition, pretty much like in other countries. And in 2024, these are the figures coming out of the data gathering accompanying that competition. Since 2017, we've been doing that competition together with government agencies. The idea was to boost the production of coffee because the Philippines apparently is among the top per capita consumers of coffee, and 90% of that actually are instant coffee drinkers. And there's a huge disparity in the consumption and the production because we rank somewhere around 30 plus. In terms of production. That sounds better than if I tell you the actual volume that we produce. We produce about 0.003% of the global volume. So even if we stop producing coffee, the world's not gonna notice at all. But being a huge per capita consumer, the local coffee industry and government recognizes that we need to boost our production. And fortunately, the U.S. Department of Agriculture came into the picture and established a coffee program called Field Cafe. And with that program came along the annual competition. And the competition, ever since it started, kind of boosted the production already because farmers are now realizing that there's money in coffee. It's demonstrated, of course, in our annual auction that follows the annual competition. These are 2023 results. And I'm showing this to you because the coffee that Paul is preparing now is from that year's third placer, Don Eliaga, who's actually the poster boy of Gourmet Farms, the biggest local coffee trader in the Philippines. Of course, I'd like to introduce to you my friend from Gourmet Farms, Vince. You'll see him a lot in this presentation. He is actually the poster boy of Gourmet Farms. And this is from Don's farm. Last year, what place was done? Ninth. It was ninth last year. And in a study that was carried out by Duke University in 2016, they helped the government, the Philippine government, come up with a policy brief. Turns out that one of the major challenges to boost the local coffee industry was we were pretty much lacking in terms of dissemination and even generation of knowledge. There's basically no data, no research, very insignificant amount. Recognizing that, and because somehow we got a little bit more heavily involved with the coffee industry, most of the problems of our friends in the coffee industry are thrown to our university. Somehow we do contribute there by doing a little bit of research, such as traceability. Because there are competitions, some traders actually sell counterfeit or mislabel their coffees. And because that's our sort of forte, we got involved by doing a research that was funded also by government. This is the data that we have here is actually going to be published in Food Chemistry. It was just accepted last Thursday. Oh, we were at the airport when we got the acceptance of this paper. The problem there is that we're not really creating a huge dent because only a few universities in the Philippines actually generate significant amount of research. We would have wanted to other universities, especially those in the coffee producing regions, to do research as well. Of course, it was very difficult to just, you know, tell them to do more research. So we sort of tried to do some, we were a little bit more strategic in terms of how could we push these universities to do more research. And not just research, but also to engage them in a discourse, in a more regular discourse. Because the reason why they're probably not producing that much research is because they don't have discussions about coffee. So with the help of our friends in the coffee industry, we had some initiative of bring around different cafes and roasteries, coffee science, because we felt that if more people embraced and understood the need for science in coffee, they'd be able to do more research and get involved in, with those studies. Then in 2018, through the generosity of one of our friends in the coffee industry, Mr. Harris, he's a Philippine National Barista Champion. He brought in John to visit Manila. And we also did host John in our university to talk about something that I felt like, that I felt that my bosses would want to, would help convince my bosses to buy this machine. So the title of the talk was Novel Data-Driven Approach. And around that time, data-driven was actually the buzzword. A few months later, we just submitted a small experiment, a proposal tailored to purchase the machine, because there's nothing else that has the same specs anyway. We got our first machine, the XL. Yeah, this was the congee place we went to, John. The only thing missing was how do we make full use of this, together with an inspiration coming from another friend of ours. This is where I did my graduate research at UC Davis, where I met Bill Ristenpart. I didn't work in his lab. I worked in the chemistry department. But for some reason, I got to meet Bill. And very popular, around that time was the first semester that UC Davis offered their coffee science course. And that was, I drew inspiration from that, although that was basically focused on heat and mass transfer, I think. Our intention was to create something in the Philippines that would cater to different or various disciplines, because we felt that in order to address issues in the local coffee industry, we have to see those problems or issues or concerns from different disciplinary lenses. So we got our machine, some inspiration coming from the UC Davis experience. We were able to get a small room in the university, which was basically the first coffee lab. And fortunately also for us, before this, Vince was already attending our regularly and quietly attending coffee science meetups. Since we already had some rapport, we engaged in some small collaborations. And then at some point, his company felt like we need to bring this to the next level. After the pandemic, his boss basically donated several millions to the university in exchange for the naming rights of the coffee laboratory, half of which was to procure equipment, and half was for an endowment fund. For research and related activities. With that fund, I told Vince we need more decent espresso machines. So we got a couple more of the XXL. Hopefully we'll get more later on in one way or another. And yeah, we have that coffee laboratory now, which is basically a sort of turning into a touristy hub in the university. This is our university chaplain. I just met him last week, and every day he goes to the lab just to have coffee after holding mass or celebrating. He's Mexican, Father Alejandro. This course is a three-unit elective. It's a general science elective course where students from various disciplines can enroll. Again, the intention was to infect more people and see the issues in the coffee industry from their lenses, so that people like me also, being a chemist by profession, I would be able to understand the connection between, let's say, economics and coffee, culture and coffee, history, all the other engineering, etc., etc. It's not surprising that the experience of the students are very, very positive. When we ask the students to submit reflection papers, it is very evident that the students actually do get to see the connections between their own disciplines and coffee science. It didn't take long. The course has been running for 5 trimesters already. It's almost 2 years. As early as last year, it's already gotten national media attention. Because of that, even the administration, not just for people from within the university, are regular visitors of the lab already. On the picture on the left, we have self-proclaimed Pour Over Thinkers Club. They think highly to themselves. But the lady beside me is the dean of the College of Engineering. She's one of the top researchers in the Philippines. The curly lady behind is a marketing professor. The guy in red is the chair of the mechanical engineering department. Every Wednesday morning, we hold coffee sessions, we discuss topics that might lead to research. The picture on the right, visitors from our sister university that caters to hotel and hospitality management. And they visited us because they want to beef up their coffee program with a little bit more technical stuff, science as well. In fact, just last week, they inaugurated their coffee bar just because I showed them last year a picture of Chris Hendon's coffee lab. They patterned it after that. They have lots of money. They have more money than my campus. The other sister university, a little bit north of Manila, has a 66-hectare farm. They're also going to do well. We already have talks in having a field trial for Robustas and Libericas. Speaking of Liberica, other sister university south of Manila, which is located in the province that is most popularized by this type of coffee, Liberica, has a lot of interest in doing Liberica. So we will be holding a Liberica symposium within the next couple of months as soon as we get confirmation from Dr. Davis, his availability schedule. He already said yes, but there's just some stuff that we have to fix. And of course, Kenny Ting, probably some of you know him as the Liberica guy in Borneo. The influence doesn't end there because a state university located in the north, the Highlands, just inaugurated their coffee center, which was actually instrumental for them to become a university. Previously, they were just a small college. They will be adapting, establishing their own academic program. We will be helping them to do that. But of course, in the context of the strength, their strong programs. They have agribusiness and forestry programs. So we will be anchoring the academic programs on those disciplines. And then even local government units, the province of in the south, in Mindanao, where most of the coffees in the Philippines are grown, will also be picking up the idea and establishing an academic program as well. Hopefully, hopefully, these schools will, because I told them that the technique in the procurement process in the Philippines to get the Excel. Because I told them the only way you can actually do science is if you have data, and you can't do data without this machine. So maybe when all of these universities have their own DEs, we can hold a conference in the Philippines in the future. This is a proof of concept. It's still at its infancy. Sorry, coffee, John. I think Vince would be the best to describe this one. Don Don's coffee.
It's a yellow bourbon that's naturally processed. The location is the southern. It's part of the southernmost region, or southernmost major island of the Philippines, the foothills of the highest peak in the Philippines, which is Mount Apo. So I hope you guys enjoy the coffee and. If you have any feedback, I'll make sure to let the partner know. Because you work very closely with this partner.
This is not the Philly PC.
The place, no?
These are not competition beans, but these are from Don Don's farm. Yeah. Should be still good.
Yeah.
All right. All right. As I mentioned a while ago, the whole idea was to just create an academic program that would sort of influence other universities because that's where it's more consequential. We wanted to improve the production, which means there has to be academic programs in the universities where coffee is grown, not in Manila. But because things happen fast in Manila, we did it there. True enough, as expected, the other universities took notice, and hopefully soon we will be generating more research. An example of which is a very elementary research. This is also a proof of concept study. We just wanted to show our stakeholders in the Philippines that we can actually do research together with coffee professionals. So one of the co-authors here is the only SCA certified judge in the Philippines, like Valdez. We just wanted to do this because we also wanted to tell all the other coffee professionals, if you have anything in mind, please do work with academic institutions. We want these ideas to be published. Otherwise, it's not going to be useful. How instrumental was the machine in creating all of this? As shown in the slide where John visited the Philippines in 2018, it's all about data. We cannot produce research if there's no data, and there's no other machine that actually allows us to gather data at the bottom line part of the value chain, which is in the consumption, than this machine. Sounds like I'm selling the machine, but but it's all right.
Next year you'll be selling half decent scales.
Hopefully. The state universities have more money than the private universities, so we'll find a way that they do get to create their programs around this. In fact, when they visit our laboratory, this is the first thing that actually catches their... Everyone else, actually, they don't even know that it is an SS machine. They're already, amazed. And they're even more amazed once we tell them that it is an espresso machine, right? Just like Ride has a YouTube channel. I think the intention from the very beginning to use the Decent machine, the DE, it's a research and an academic instrument. It's pretty much like a YouTube video. You can utilize it by building to attract attention. It by itself, it actually serves as the hook. And once you have it, once you're familiar with operating it, you're already generating ideas. Once you're able to generate ideas, you can start connecting it to more serious stuff, which allows you to build more consequential stuff that will be relevant to the coffee industry. That's where we are so far, and hopefully we'll have more people involved, more universities involved, and maybe 2-3 years down the line, our projection is that we'll be starting to produce more research already. Now it's just basically laying the groundwork. On behalf of the Philippine Coffee Guild, which also I do represent, I would like to invite you if you're in the area. We'll be holding our annual National Coffee Expo this coming May 9 to 11 in Makati City, which is basically the business district in Metro Manila. So, thank you so much.